Hi, I'm Ethel Kofi.
I'm Thea Sokolowski.
We're hosting the Women in Tech event today with
Next Wave Africa.
And today's event is going to be about entrepreneurship and how to write a business plan and how to pitch to investors.
Sure, so I'll be speaking about best practices in terms of pitching and writing a pitch, and then we'll have Brett Calhoun, who's with Tigo, come in and talk about how to speak with investors and negotiate. Okay, so when you're thinking about your pitch, some of the key questions that you want to answer is, what is your product? Research has actually shown that you have about 2 minutes to get an investor's attention. So total, we want to make sure that formal pitches are under 7 minutes. Okay, so no more than 7 minutes should be spent talking about it. So I've seen some pitches, sometimes we think it's necessary to go through sort of the whole business plan, right? But the business plan exists so they can read it after, right? The purpose of the pitch is just to get their attention and pique their interest, okay? So we wanna keep it as short as possible, okay? So concisely outline what you intend to do and how you intend to do it, right? So the how part is just as important, okay? We wanna know that you have a plan. Right, you can have a fantastic idea and a great team, but we want to know that you have thought through how you're going to actually make this happen if we're going to give you our money. So the first thing and most important thing is branding. Okay, you should have a logo. You should have a sort of palette, right, that goes with your brand. So that branding should be visible on all of your slides. Throughout your entire pitch deck, on your business plan, it should be there. So we know and always remember who you are, right? What's your brand called? What does it look like? Okay, and that should be visible throughout your presentation. So we want to make sure that we outline what that problem is and what our solution to that problem is, right? And very important, how it works, okay? Because we can have a great idea that sounds great on paper, but if you can't express how it works, we don't get a full understanding of what that idea is, right? Followed by your value proposition. So again, every business also has a target audience, right? And they have needs. So what is the value that you're providing to that target audience with your product? Okay, that's what we wanna get across. And also the market opportunity. So making sure that you've done your research, okay? These are the things that are going on in this industry, right? This is the opportunity that we found in the market. This is why we think that there are people who will buy our product, basically. Right? The idea is only 50% of it, right? There's been many, many, many wonderful ideas that have never come to life because the team couldn't execute, right? So we also want to have confidence in the team who's going to be executing this product, okay? So make sure we don't forget to talk about them, okay? Okay, so starting with the business overview. So the business overview of your presentation should answer this question: what do you do? Very quickly, okay? So want to make sure that in the first couple of seconds, we've given a little hint at what it is we're actually proposing, right? So I know immediately, okay, I'm getting into this mindset, you know, I'm talking about a tech product, I'm talking about a beauty product. So we do, we do what? So using, say, women in tech as an example, we create networking and educational opportunities for who? For females that work in tech in Ghana. Right, or interested in tech in Ghana, by uniquely providing speakers, mentors, and events here at iSpace. Right? Why do we think that there's a need for women in tech to exist? Right? What is the problem that we're trying to fill? So then we're gonna talk about how the product works, right? How do we come to that solution? How do we solve these problems? So what we want to tell investors, who our product is intended for, okay? Very important. We wanna make sure that you know your target. Right, because you're supposed to know how to reach that target. So you need to know everything about them and about their needs. Even if it's a product that's, say, an NGO, you need to sustain yourself, right? So I need to have some idea of where the funds are going to come from to help you, right? And finally, how will you deliver that product? Okay, so what are the channels that you'll go through? If it's a tech product, can I find it online? Can I find it as an app in the iOS store, right? How are you going to actually distribute that product? So what is it, what is the benefit that you're gonna provide to your customers? Okay, and we have to talk about this specifically in terms of benefits. Our value proposition, when it's stated, is relevant to what we're talking about, right? And very clear. so that it reduces any anxiety or distractions that your investors might feel about your product. And so investors need to understand you're offering in the face of competition. Okay, so everybody has competition. Competition could even just be anything else that your customers can do to solve the need you're filling, right? So even if it's not another brand that's doing exactly the same thing you do, it's still competition because they can choose that over your product, right? So what you wanna make your investors understand with your value proposition is why people would choose your product over anything else. And how is it compelling? Why is it interesting? Right? Why is your product more interesting than what's currently available? And again, what is that pain point? What is that thing that we're addressing, that we're solving through our product? Basically, what you want to think about is, what's that thing that your customer wakes up in the middle of the night and says, oh, I really need that, right? It's probably not phrased the way that you would phrase your benefits, right? Like, oh, I really don't need an easy way to make mobile online payments. But it's probably like, oh man, I wish that I had paid my bills earlier on time, right? So what is the benefit? That's the benefit, that thing that'll wake that person up in the middle of the night. They slap their head and say, oh God, I wish I had this, right? All right, so following value proposition. So now we know what your product is, what need you're solving, right? Who it's intended for. And we know what value you're providing to that intended audience. Now we want to know, okay, why is there a need for this product in the market? What's going on elsewhere in that market? And why do we think that people will actually pay for this? And the size of that market, right? So in addition to the pain, they want to know, why now? Why is this the best time, right? If you're creating a mobile app, maybe it's because mobile penetration has reached an all-time high here in Ghana, right? And you see it rising. That would indicate there being space in the market for this product, right? Now's a good time for people to adopt it because everything that needs to be in place is now coming into place, right? Why is it urgent? Why is there a need for this right now, right? Why do you feel that people will be compelled enough to actually make the purchase decision? Your revenue potential. So, okay, if I have this many people that can possibly buy my product, what does that mean for me in terms of the money I can make? Why does that prove that there is potential for me to make revenue off of this? So you want to define that space that your product will fill. Okay? We are part of this industry, right? These are the customers that we're going after. These are our competitors in that space, right? This is where we sit in this market. Whom we're selling it to, so who is that actual audience? How we're going to sell it, that's our marketing strategy, our communication strategy, right? What's the core message that we want to get across to this audience? And where are we going to do that? So when we have a target audience, they're not all the same, right? Everybody has sort of different, comes from a different place. You want to look at different age brackets, different needs, right? So how is our market divided? Because right? You want to sort of speak to each of the different parts separately, right? Because they have different needs that you're addressing. Right, so when you're speaking to one part of your market, you're going to highlight maybe different values or different benefits than you would when speaking to another part of the market who might use your product in another way. Okay? How and where will you market your product? Right? Brand awareness, marketing, very important. How are you going to make sure that people know about your product and know that they have an opportunity to come and use it? Right? So what are the channels that you're going to go through? And what is that core message? Right? What's your positioning? What's that one thing that makes your brand unique that you want to tell people? And in this, there's no right answer, right? The investors are not looking for you to have all of the questions answered and everything figured out, right? But they just want to see that you've thought it through, right? They want to see depth. So you have a plan. You know how you're going to go about attacking it if you have this investment, right? You're not just sort of going to wing it, right? But you don't have to, you know, have planned out every single activity for the next couple years, okay? Right, so practice, 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 because it shows that you have confidence in and knowledge of your product. If it's something you have to highlight sort of briefly at the beginning, make sure you do so we can get into the mindset of exactly what we're gonna be hearing for the next few minutes, okay? Keep it concise and easy to understand, right? So we're not reciting our whole business plan, we're just talking about the main points, okay, as briefly as possible. Also, one thing I've noticed a couple of times, make sure that we don't want to talk about equity terms in a pitch. Okay, that's something that should be negotiated in a conversation with an investor following the pitch. Okay. The idea of a pitch is just to pique their interest so you get that meeting, so you get that conversation. Okay. Because the terms that you offer may not be the same thing an investor was thinking. Right. So you always want to save that for a private conversation. Okay. You don't need to get into too specific details on exactly how much you need for what. That is important, but that should be saved for a business plan, right? Which they will read after, okay? And as I mentioned earlier, include your branding throughout the entire deck, right? We don't wanna forget who you are, don't wanna forget what your branding looks like, what your product name is.
Yeah. I just participated in a great event by Next Wave here in Ghana, which is a group that focuses on female entrepreneurs in Ghana. And I did a presentation on financing, sourcing financing, talking to investors, and what you need to know before and what you need to do during that process. I got some great questions from the audience, and I'm quite excited about the future of entrepreneurship in Ghana.
I spend a lot of time with people that want to invest in Ghana. And we have a tendency in Ghana to make our angel investors demon investors. And let me say why I say that. When you have an investor, that investor's money is their money. For some reason, the mentality here doesn't feel that way. I have several cases that I'm working on right now in facilitations where when business people have an angel investor that's willing to work with them, they send their money to do certain things. They expect reports. They expect to see how that's going. And it's not happening. And the communication breaks down. Money is being misused and put someplace else. And so there are not a whole lot of angel investors left out there in Ghana right now. And I'd like you to speak on that and see if you've seen the same thing as well.
So yeah, I have seen it. And it's unfortunate. And I think it speaks to a lack of understanding on the part of recipients of money here, right? There's not a history of angel investing here. In general, what you have is, or what I've seen here is, you know, you have a member of, say, a family, uncle, or father, or someone who has money to set up people very close to him, right? And then he also probably lives here. So there is an automatic monitoring. So those are the cases I've seen that have gone quite well. Unfortunately, the general other cases where there's more distance, there's not a culture around feeling that responsibility to someone you didn't know. So everyone kind of laughed and I said, if you borrow money from your mom, you're going to work really hard to like make something out of it. Because
it's your mother and, you know, or your sister or your brother. It could be, you know, any close family member that's watching you. But anyone who looks at the space will notice that microfinance doesn't work the same way here as it was kind of became famous for in India, which is people will, and it's horrible, but people will be so upset about not being able to pay back that some people were killing themselves and they had to modify the industry. I've never heard of anybody in Ghana who said, I can't pay this microfinance loan and I'm going to kill myself.